Hey, what's up everybody? Rob Marzullo here, Ram Studio Comics, and today's video I'm going to show you how to kind of form a scene. So it's time-lapsed, obviously. I can't really draw this fast. I wish I could. So I'm time-lapsing the scene, and what the scene is the helm to Blackstone's ship. So, you know, my comic book character Blackstone Eternal, which you can find on Indie Planet, blah blah blah. And you know, this is me just constructing a scene, you know, first doing the thumbnail rough sketch and throwing in some perspective lines. This is done in a one-point perspective. You can kind of see that vanishing point on the horizon line, and it's a bit of a downward shot. So, and also I want to take this time to thank everybody for hitting the 10,000 subscriber mark. Extremely excited about that and very happy with those results. You know, I have been working on the channel for a good year and a half, so I don't know if that's good or bad or whatever, but I never really expected it to go that far, this far or whatever. And I just want to thank everybody that's been participating and helping promote the channel and sharing videos and stuff like that. It's all really cool and really exciting stuff for me. You know, I just, kind of looked at it as a way to connect with other artists, and, yeah, it's turned into a fun little, networking community and things like that, and way to share art and for all of us to learn and grow together. So pretty cool. So at any rate, thanks for the 10,000 subs. And then also, I'll kind of explain the process here. I'm not extremely great at backgrounds. So I struggle a little bit. I'm using Sketchbook Pro 7, which has got these new perspective tools, which I really like. You can pop them on and off. It lends itself really well to the effect of drawing, you know, interactively in perspective. Manga Studio's got them too. I like them both. I use them both. But this one, if I feel there's something that I want to be a little bit more, I don't know what the word is, organic or flowing or more natural, I go with this one. So, you know, you see some of my background stuff. I kind of struggle to give it, I don't know, cool form or whatever. But I just keep playing with it. And, you know, you get better over time. So, I'm just happy with the fact that my backgrounds look better than they did, you know, 5 years ago or whatever. So, you know, I start drawing in all these little techie lines. I'm trying to, excuse me, add angles and different shapes so as to not look too, you know, rudimentary or you know, not futuristic, you know, like basic architecture you'd see today, you know. So that's really my goal, why I added those weird looking H-shaped windows and the breaks and the angled floor that he's kind of sitting on, and the helm that sits up, and you know, the rounded screens. All those things are just me trying to make it look a little bit more techy and futuristic. And the reason why I wanted to show you this style of forming a scene, it's just a one-point perspective. All the other stuff is just me drawing lines and then trying to straighten them out. But the majority of all the angles and the stuff that you see in the scene are just from a one-point perspective. Like the screens there, I'm just doing freehand, and you know, it shows, you know. But you know, I think that you've got to hodgepodge some of that together. You've got to mix a little bit of freehand in there. You don't want it too overly structured and everything just being a straight architectural type line, you know, which isn't bad. I'm just saying that you know, I think there's a certain vibe that you get to your designs and your even your scenery if you mix a little bit of hand drawn in there. So that's what I do. And, you know, I just basically keep working up the form, adding little pieces, taking things away, like I do in anything. Like if I draw a character, I use the same kind of effect where I'm nitpicking the work and moving things around. You'll see in a minute here, I grab that screen. I am taking the wires out just because even though it's cool to draw wires, it's like, it's the future. I mean, wouldn't everything, we're already almost wireless, so, or pretty much are wireless, so the future is definitely going to be wireless, you know. In all reality, how I even have an arm on the back, I mean, wouldn't the screen just be floating at that point? You know, like Bots over there, his little sidekick to his right, or his left, all right, he's floating, you know. It's like, I'm sure in the future, everything just floats. I can't be sure, but I'm almost sure. You know, we almost have the hoverboard, for Pete's sakes, from, you know, Back to the Future. So anyways, so now I'm drawing the form in the scene, and that was mainly the question that I was asked by one of the viewers, and how do you do that? And so what I was trying to show here is that I work the scene out first, and then I start forming the character, and you can see that he still doesn't quite fit, so I keep adjusting the lines a little bit, I shrunk the bottom portion of the legs because I have to picture that the camera is up in the air looking down on the character. So certain things are going to recess into space. Like in all reality, I probably should have grabbed his feet, moved them closer together, and recessed the lower calf area even more. Because you have to remember that because you're looking downward, again, things are going to recess back into space. Like for instance, his chest is going to be more prominent than his sternum and his stomach muscles and things like that because you're looking down on him a bit. You're not right over top of him, so you have to be subtle with that. But anyway, that's how I form, would draw a character in that scene. Once the scene is laid out, the character becomes a lot easier to perceive in that perspective. So hopefully that answers your question. That's kind of the reason I did this video. I gotta start writing down the names of the people that ask with the question so I can respond back like a shout out, but I didn't. But you know who you are, so just comment below if this video was helpful to you. And share, like, subscribe. So now I've got pretty much the scene down. Now I've brought it into Photoshop. I like doing my tones in Photoshop. Sorry I'm not showing the interface here, but since I was gonna use two softwares and I knew that, I'd just rather not do that. But so now I'm just painting in value or tone. And this is an approach that is kind of nice if you're like me, where you come more from a traditional comic book illustration, I don't know, drawing background versus a paint. I wasn't a painter growing up or anything like that. So this lends itself a little bit more to our way of thinking if you're that type of artist. I think, anyways, because I was so used to using, like, maybe some Prismacolor markers at the very best, but I just didn't get much into color. I was a lot more into just pen and ink was my whole thing. So, but now with digital and, it's so much faster, and sometimes it's hard to find, at least for me, good other artists to, work with. So I just basically, just do it myself. And it's like, I'm sure I don't get the best results. Obviously somebody's just great at coloring, they're gonna stand tall and just blow, smoke my work or whatever. But it's just one of them things where, I can practice and get good enough, get decent enough at it. So all I'm doing is adding value. I add a little bit of highlights as I go, so I basically grab each area, shade it down, add a little bit of highlights, a little bit of specular highlights. I try to make the values a little bit different on each object, mainly because, well, for one, if you take a color photo, convert it to grayscale, you'll see that how many subtle values there are in it, and it's good to study that because you don't quite realize that. So then when you shade your artwork and then you go to apply color over it, you're looking at it going, wow, why doesn't the color line up? Why isn't it bright enough or dark enough in these areas? Really, it's just because you're not, knowledgeable enough on the way that values work yet, and myself included. I mean, I'm no pro at this, but I'm starting to recognize it, and that's why I'm sharing it with you. One of the things that my channel is here for isn't so much as me being some elaborate teacher or, some really educated higher than thou type person. My thing is, I'm basically traveling through this journey of art and I'm learning. So as I learn, I'm sharing it with you. So really, this is more me learning than me teaching you, but it's a share, a process where we can share the knowledge. It's also why I'm real open when people say, hey, have you tried this? Have you seen that? I'm not like, oh, I already know all that. I don't need you to tell me. I'm very open to gaining new knowledge myself. One of the reasons I started this is because I watch these videos from other artists like intensely. I love watching new work come out and, studying it and learning new techniques. So if you see what I'm doing here, I'm actually painting in each shape and then I'm erasing it. And I've picked that up off another artist. I can't remember who at this point, but I thought it was a really great technique because it seems counterproductive, but it's really not. It seems kind of quick in some ways. Because you kind of paint free-flowingly, erase real fast. I don't know, it seems like it almost saves time, but I've been doing it more and more. So in stars, you see I just kind of try to shoot some stars with a spatter brush and then hodgepodge and move them around, and there's some my attempt at a little bit of Kirby crackle off to the side there. And then now the highlights in the windows, this is all done with just a hard round brush. With the opacity turned down, just so you know, and I just mess around and keep adding and subtracting. And but the thing I like about this value process is it's just dark and light. I'm not having to worry about color at this point. I'm just worrying about shading. Here I use a quick mask. If you're familiar with Photoshop, you can paint your mask interactively by hitting Q. It turns everything pink like this, and then you draw with black or white to add or take away the quick mask. Hit Q again, and you got just a selection. Really neat feature. So, and I also want to use this opportunity to tell you about what we're going to be doing in the future of this channel. I'm actually going to be doing a lot more detailed study of anatomy. I just recently did a course, and I'll make that available once it's out, for another company where I drew detailed kind of comic book artwork for them. They found me on the YouTube channel here, which was great, and I did a series of courses. But then it also made me think about what I'm doing on here, and I think I need to do a very extremely detailed anatomy study with you guys, and it'll be on my blog and on here and all that good stuff. But I honestly don't know the stuff in full detail like I should, so I'm gonna go into full detail of the muscles and where they go, where they stop, the names, and it'll just be an opportunity for me to study and kind of go to that next level, but also to work with you guys and get your feedback and input and all that fun stuff. So that'll be on the horizon for the YouTube channel here, God willing, of course. And it's just still painting in some value here, some light and dark, trying to add some depth to the little console area there. This process is just really easy to kind of focus on, and that's what I like about it. You're kind of breaking down the whole process from just worrying about dark and light right now, like I said, which is more my strong suit, even though I still got a lot to learn with value. But I'm better with black and white and maybe tones versus the coloring is where I tend to be stifled a bit. So here, just painting a planet, and I just grabbed like a texture brush and just kind of overlaid it a few times. I don't know, it came out real good, but I didn't spend much time on it. And then there I'm adding some final light sources to try to draw attention to Blackstone. And you see I didn't put a lot of detail on him, but he's so tiny in this scene, I have a hard time wanting to, detail him out. I just feel like it'll be wasted on this type of scene. I also add like a dust and scratches here in a bit, which, makes it look a little more blended. And then I paint over top of that a little bit. Here I'm adding some lights in the floor. At least that's what that's supposed to be, all that yellow that I'm putting in there. And, try to show a little bit of light source with some glows and drawing, painting in his armor. So just throwing in the color here and there as I go. And detailing it out. Yeah, coming to a close. So yeah, hopefully this video has helped you. Hopefully you've learned something or enjoyed it. And if you have, likes, subscribe, share, all that fun stuff. Let me know what you'd like to see in the future, because I do really try to work that into my schedule. And, if you get a chance, check out the Blackstone Eternal comic on Indie Planet. Book 2 should be available soon. I'm just trying to work on it in between, all my other umpteen things that I have to do. But, when I get free time, I go to the book and do stuff like this. So, thanks very much for watching, and keep drawing, keep having fun, and we will talk to you soon. Bye-bye.